It's common in RPGs to have a menu cursor that's controlled by button inputs or a D-pad. It maps nicely to a controller and makes it really obvious what option the player is about to select. Using Godot's scene system, we can design such a cursor in a way that's reusable for every menu your game has. At its core, our cursor is just a texture that can move around the UI, so we'll pick Godot's texture rec node as a starting point in a new scene. Set the cursor sprite to be whatever you want in the texture property. I'm using this pixel art hand cursor I found on OpenGameArt, which I'll link in the description. Next, give the scene a name and add a script to it called menucursor.gd. Since our cursor is going to be used in lots of different layouts throughout the game, it should be programmed to accommodate every different layout we throw at it. Here's a test scene I made with some common RPG menu layouts. We have a vertical list of labels made with a VBox container, a horizontal list made with an HBox container, and a grid made using a grid container. Our cursor should be able to navigate all of these. In the script, create an export variable called menuParentPath with a type of nodePath. Now instance that cursor scene in whatever UI scene you want it to be in. In the editor, set that variable to the container that your menu options are under, which in my case is this VBox container. Right after that, create an onReady variable called menuParent and set it to getNodeMenuParentPath. Since all of the menu items we want to interact with should be direct children of menuParent, we can access them in order using an integer index. Let's store the index of the currently selected menu item with a new variable called cursorIndex, which defaults to 0 or the first option in the menu. Now define a method called getMenuItemAtIndex, taking an int variable called index as an argument, and returning a control node. This method is first going to check that the parent is valid and that the child index is within range. If they aren't, it returns null. To do so, we should just use some if statements, if parent equals null, return null, and if index is greater than or equal to parent node.getChildCount or index is less than 0, return null. Now that we know both the parent and index are valid at this point, we can write return menuParent.getChildIndex as control, which is the menu item at the given index. Now create a method called setCursorFromIndex, again taking an index as a parameter, but this time returns void. Create a variable called menuItem and set it to getMenuItemAtIndex, index. Check that it's valid again, if not, return null. This method is going to actually change the position of the cursor based on the position and size of the menu item at index. I'm going to assume you want the cursor centered vertically and off to the left, horizontally like this. If not, you can change it to suit your needs later if need be. Get a reference to the position and size of the menu item using rec global position and rec size respectively. Now set the cursor's rec global position variable to a new vector 2 with position.x for the x value and position.y plus size.y divided by 2 for the y. This is the midpoint on the left side of the menu item. As you can see in this diagram though, this would place the top left corner of the cursor at this point, where ideally it would place the center of the cursor here. To do that, subtract rec size divided by 2 from this position to correctly offset it. For artistic control, let's add an export variable called cursor offset with the type of vector 2 and also subtract it from our position. That way we can move the cursor around so it's closer to or farther away from each menu item. Here's the offset value I'm using for this hand cursor. It gives it a nice margin on the left and also makes it to where the tip of the finger is pointing at the options, not the center of the hand. Finally, write cursor index equals index. Create the process function next and a variable inside it called input, which will default to vector2.0. Using the default UI input bindings, or custom ones if you have them set up, we can compose our input vector from the directional buttons just press this frame. I'm sure you've all set up an input vector like this before, so you probably know what to do here. It's just a bunch of if-else statements using input that is action just pressed for each directional button and adding or subtracting from the correct axis. Make sure you use is action just pressed though, not is action pressed, otherwise your menu controls are going to require frame perfect precision to navigate, which is probably not what you want. We know what direction the player is trying to move now, but how we actually handle that input is going to depend on the container our menu items are stored in. First, let's check if the menu parent is a VBox container. If it is, we should probably use vertical controls since it's a vertical list. To do so, let's move the current cursor index by the value of input.y by calling setCursorFromIndex cursorIndex plus input.y. Next, write elif menuParent is HBox container. We'll handle this the same way we handled the vertical container, this time swapping input.y with input.x. Testing this really quick by setting up the correct menuParent path, and it seems to work. Both vertical and horizontal menus seem to be functioning. All we need to do now is navigate grid menus. As you can see in this diagram, the index of each child in a grid container is equal to their x position plus their y position multiplied by the number of columns. We can offset our index then by adding the value of input.x to move horizontally and input.y multiplied by menuParent.columns to move vertically. This is what that code looks like. Setting the menuParent path to my grid container and testing it out, and you can see we navigate the grid exactly as we intended. All that's left is a way for the cursor to actually select an option in our menu. Create a new script called menuItem that extends label, give it a signal cursor selected, and a function called cursorSelect. For testing purposes, I'm going to make it print its name in the console cancel when it's called, so we can make sure the right menu item is actually being selected. After that, make it emit the cursor selected signal. Back in the cursor script, check if the player is trying to select something using input.isActionJustPressed UIselect in the process function. Create a new variable called currentMenuItem and set it to getMenuItemAtIndex cursorIndex. If currentMenuItem is not null, check if it has the cursorSelect method with currentMenuItem.has method cursorSelect. If that's true too, then we can finally call currentMenuItem.cursorSelect. Make sure all your menu items have that script applied, run the game, and test it. You should see when you press spacebar that the name of each label is printed in the console. To use this in an actual game, you would just connect each menu item's cursorSelected signal like you would, say, button down on a button. So in a battle menu, you could connect your attack function to the cursorSelected signal on the corresponding option in the menu. Now selecting with the cursor makes the player attack. With that, you have an easy-to-use menu cursor for your game that will work pretty much anywhere with minimal setup. If you got stuck anywhere along the way though, the cursor script is available on GitHub with a link in the description below, and if you're still stuck after taking a look at that or have other questions, feel free to reach out in the comments and I'll try to help however I can.